We have seen that Newton's method, when it works, may work quite fast, but that it also does not always work. It means that it does not always converge. So in this video, we will identify the conditions that will guarantee the convergence of the method. And we'll also try to characterize the speed of convergence. Finally, we will show the equations that extends Newton's method from one variable to a system of n equations with n variables. There are three conditions that are sufficient to guarantee the convergence of Newton's method. The first one is that the function f must not be too nonlinear. Actually, it makes sense when you think about it, because Newton's method relies on a linear model of the function. If the function is really badly nonlinear, this linear model will be of poor quality, and the method may not work quite well. If you remember, the way to characterize the level of nonlinearity of a function relies on the concept of Lipschitz continuity. So we say that the derivative of f is Lipschitz continuous if there exists a constant m, which is strictly positive, such that the difference between the derivatives of f among two points, x and y, is bounded by the distance between x and y times this constant m. Of course, if m is very small, very close to zero, the two values here will be also very close. It means that the derivative of the function is close, so the slope is closed, and the function is close to being linear. So small m means a function which is almost linear. Big m means the function is very nonlinear. The second condition is related to the definition of the algorithm. Remember, during the algorithm, we have to divide by the derivative of f. And of course, if it is zero, it does not work. But actually, if it is close to zero, it will not work very well either. So the second condition says that for the derivative of the function must be bounded away from zero. So there exists a constant rho, which is strictly positive, such that the absolute value of the derivative is greater or equal to rho for any x. So the derivative is bounded away for zero so that we can safely divide by the derivative of f. And the last one says that the method will work if we start it relatively close to the solution. So it means that there exists a neighborhood around the solution in which the starting point belongs. And actually, this is kind of an annoying condition, because in practice, how do you want to make sure to verify that? Because you don't know the solution, right? This is why you use the algorithm. So it means that it will converge to a solution if it starts from a point which is close to the solution. And then there is a theorem that says that the iterates of Newton's method that are reported here are well defined. So it's valid to divide by f prime of xk, because the derivative is bounded away from zero. The sequence converges to a point x star, which is actually a root of the equation. And it converges q quadratically. So what does it mean, q quadratically? It means that we can calculate the distance between the next iterate and the solution. And this distance is bounded by the distance of the previous iterate, xk, and the solution, squared. Well, it's not that simple. There is also a constant that will multiply this quantity, which involves the Lipschitz constant and the parameter rho that was defining the fact that the derivative is bounded away from zero. So the notion of q quadratically comes from the fact that we have a 2 here. So it means that at each iteration, the precision of the solution is doubled. Of course, the quality of this convergence, of the speed of convergence, will change with m. So if m is small, the convergence will be faster. Remember, if m is small, the function is close to be linear. And in the other direction, if m is bigger, then the convergence will be slower. So when we have a very nonlinear function, Newton's method will be slower. So the influence of parameter rho goes into the other direction because it appears at the denominator. So when rho is big, we will have a fast convergence. So what does it mean when rho is big? It means the derivative of f is very far away from zero. And in the other direction, when rho is small, it slows down the speed of the convergence of the method. And when rho is small, it means that the derivative of f is close to zero. So the proof of the theorem is out of the scope of this course. If you are interested, you can look at theorem 7.7 in the book. We have seen this concept in the context of one equation of one variable, because it was simpler, but they extend directly to the case of a system of n equations with n variables. So let's write down the equations to get the version of Newton's method for n equations and n variables. So here, the statement of the problem involves a function which takes n variables and returns n values, so these are the n equations, and we would like to find the x such that f of x is equal to zero. So this is the statement of the problem. Let's remember the definition of the gradient matrix. So the gradient matrix is a matrix in which each column is the gradient of the corresponding equation. So this is gradient of equation 1, equation 2, up to equation n. So this is another way to write this gradient matrix. But sometimes, and it's actually the case in the context of Newton's method, it's convenient to use the transpose of this matrix, which is then called the Jacobian. So the Jacobian matrix is a matrix where each row corresponds to the derivatives of a different equation. So Newton's method relies on a linear model. So what is a linear model in the context of a function from Rn to Rn? Well, it's basically the same. We use Taylor's theorem. So we have the value of the function and x hat plus the gradient matrix transpose times x minus x hat. Or we can write it using the Jacobian, because the Jacobian is the transpose of the gradient matrix. We have the Jacobian times x minus x hat. And now the iterations of Newton's methods are as follows. So we have the current iterate xk, which is a vector of Rn. And then we complete it using a direction dk, which is also a vector of Rn. And what that solves the system of linear equation defined by the Jacobian. So this is the Jacobian times dk is equal to minus f of xk. So if the Jacobian is invertible, which we'll assume it is, we will have the Jacobian inverse times the value of the function. Okay, so we have a very similar format as in the one-dimensional case. So it's minus the value of the function divided by the derivatives. And this is now written using matrices and vectors. So in this video, we have identified the conditions for which the method will converge. We have seen three of them. The function cannot be too nonlinear. The derivative of the function should be bounded away from zero. And the starting point of the iterates should not be too far away from the solution. We have also characterized the speed of convergence, that we call quadratic, or Q quadratically convergent was the exact terms. So basically, roughly speaking, it means that the precision will double at each iteration. And finally, we have provided the equations that generalize the methods of Newton from one equation with one variable to a system of n equations and n variables.